Coming your way this evening as the sun sets over Puget Sound in Seattle, the seventh and final game to decide the Seattle Regional Champion and who will move on to the Super Regional. We're having this game because earlier today, Washington, in a must-win situation, did win. Morgan Flores with their second home run of this regional against Michigan pitchers in the first inning. Then in the second inning, Jaylen Alton with this RBI double plated Sarah Willis. The rest was Gabby Plain, 31st win of the season. She got the shutout, and Washington avenged their loss yesterday to Michigan that sent them into the loser's bracket, winning it by the final of 2-0. And the winner of tonight's game will get to go to Norman, Oklahoma to take on the number one overall seed, Oklahoma, with a decisive 24-7 win over Wichita State. And we welcome you to Seattle. Here it is, Jen. It all comes down to one game. Jenny Dalton Hill, the former University of Arizona, three-time All-American and national champion. I'm Pam Ward, and this is what we anticipated when we saw this matchup coming up. Neither Washington nor Michigan thought they should have this matchup in the region. Not only do we have it, but we have it with everything on the line.
Yeah, both of these teams criminally underseeded coming into this matchup here in Washington, the 16 seed. And Washington pushes the if necessary game coming against with that win in our first game of the night here. So both of these teams now backs up against the wall. It's win or go home.
And we got great pitchers. Megan Bobian lost earlier today, but they have Alex Sirocco. Washington, plan A, plan B, plan C. Gabby Plain going again.
Definitely. All three of those plans end with Gabby Plain. Top three finalists for National Player of the Year, Pac-12 Pitcher of the Year, number three in the country in strikeouts with 314 before the last game. 31 wins on the season, but she's going to have to come against Alex Sirocco. Sirocco able to get the win yesterday against Washington, a complete game three hitter. So she's got the fifth lowest ERA in the country, Big Ten Pitcher of the Year, and led the Big Ten in wins, ERA, and strikeouts. Leads the country in strikeouts per seven innings. Will she be able to get the win for Michigan again today?
Yes, sub one ERA, Michigan and Washington. The Wolverines and the Huskies playing to keep their season alive and to take a trip to Norman. Welcome back to Seattle, just moments away from the first pitch between Michigan and Washington in this true regional final. Wolverines coached by Carol Hutchins, Big Ten champs yet again. 22 titles, three in a row, and 12 of the last 13, but still unseeded and sent out to take on Washington. They won the Big Ten, finishing eight games ahead of the second place team, Minnesota, who was eliminated by UCLA earlier today in the Los Angeles region. We take a look at the Michigan starting lineup, brought to you by Capital One. And in the 2-0 loss to Washington earlier today, Lexi Blair, two hits, the rest of her teammates 0-for.
Yeah, she sets the tone, but so far, no one else able to come against Gabby Plain in the first game of the night. They're going to have to figure her out quickly and put some runs up on the board for Sirocco in the circle.
Blair, the Big Ten Player of the Year, has been doing her job so far. Washington came in second to number two overall seed UCLA during the regular season in the Pac-12. RPI of 16, ranked in the top five for the entire season, but still got the number 16 seed. So coming in, both of these teams feeling that they were disrespected and underseeded. Sis Bates, number 22, right in the thick of things, trying to get people fired up and punch their ticket to a Super Regional to play Oklahoma, Virginia Tech, Georgia, James Madison, all unseeded teams that have pushed on through. Three slots still to be decided tonight, including this game. Oregon, Texas still playing, Arizona, Mississippi still playing, and now we've got Washington and Michigan, the sequel Actually, the third time they have played. They played yesterday, and with Starocco in the circle, Washington was defeated 2-1. And then it was the 2-0 win for Washington just a little while ago. And Jen, this is what we expected. Michigan with the lowest team earned run average in the country. And then you have Gabby playing in the circle for Washington, who is one of the three National Player of the Year finalists. So a pitcher's duels, and we have certainly seen that. And we anticipate that in this game. As Heather Tarr tries to get her team back to the Super Regional. In fact, that loss to Michigan yesterday was the first time that Washington has ever lost a regional game in Seattle. They had been 31-0, now 33-1 after this season, or after today's earlier win. Taylor Bump had a home run off Gabby Plain in the Michigan win yesterday, along with Lou Allen. So a quick turnaround. The team's having to get ready and play to keep their season going.
When
and
I
here
think that
is Gabby.
When it comes to pitching duels, we are going to see a really good one. Gabby Plain actually just threw the last game, but she comes back for Washington in the circle. She's just a spinner. On the Australian national team, was able to go home and really develop herself as a pitcher this last year, as she was able to go home during that COVID pause. And she is all about spin. Not only does she have improved velocity, but those tighter spins have given her better movement. Just a complete pitcher, nasty mix of speeds, and makes even the best hitters look silly.
Went all seven innings, just giving up those two hits earlier today to Lexi Blair, and did that in under 100 pitches. So a nice efficient game for Plain, who did not pitch the second game yesterday when Washington beat Seattle to keep their season going. And now one more time against the Wolverines. Sis Bates, number 22, who should be the National Defensive Player of the Year, if that award existed. And she, before every game, four shots of espresso to get herself going. I don't know if she needs that much, but the energy is always there. Four shots of espresso sounds like a good idea right about now, doesn't it, Jen?
I would take that, definitely. This is a great matchup, and we get to see it again here in the nightcap. The if-necessary game pushed forward because Washington won that first game of the night.
And away we go. Lexi Blair, the only Wolverine to get a hit. She was 2-for-3. In fact, hit the first pitch she saw from Plain in the first inning earlier tonight for a base hit. And she picks up right where she left off. Now 3-for-4 against Plain today.
Well, sitting at the top of the lineup, she has done her job. She's pushed the ball into the outfield. In the last game, we saw her get that line drive to center to start things off, and then a ground ball over there to the right side. Lexi Blair at the top of the lineup is doing everything she can. It's the rest of the Wolverines that are going to have to step up in this one. But she sets the tone there in the leadoff slot.
So Lexi Blair 2-for-3 against Gabby Plain tonight. Her teammates a combined 0-for-20. Gets the bunt down to advance. Blair, good job by Rodriguez.
Well, not only is that a great job by Rodriguez to get the ball down, but Klingler had to charge so hard and so far to get to this ball. Perfectly placed. Great defensive play. Rodriguez almost able to speed that one out.
And that sets up Lou Allen, the number 3 hitter. Hit a home run off Gabby Plain yesterday in the 2-1 Michigan win. Did draw a walk against Plain in the game earlier this evening. That's a single. Lexi Blair coming around to score. Michigan breaks on top first. Lexi Blair coming in on the Lou Allen RBI single.
And we saw Gabby Plain filling the bottom of the zone in the first game, but Lou Allen makes a great adjustment on a pitch that just hangs at the knees. Great job driving it right back up the middle. Good balanced swing, and with speed on the bases because of that bunt, Lexi Blair was at second, able to score.
Michigan coming out aggressively, swinging early in the count. And now here's Taylor Bump, who along with Allen are the two best home run hitters on this Wolverine team. Up with 12 homers, one more than Allen, who is over on first.
Just missed that one, Pam. That ball up in the zone has a good little wiggle up, a little rise ball out of the hands of Gabby Plain. We saw her fill the bottom of the zone for the last game. I'm curious to see how she will manipulate the strike zone and try to reinvent herself, as all of these Michigan hitters are now seeing her for the fourth and fifth time.
1-2 pitch. Nine pitches, six swings so far for the Michigan hitters against Gabby Plain.
Yeah, they didn't just see Gabby Plain in the game before this one. They also saw her yesterday. She threw six innings, and so this is not a new look for them. Gabby Plain gonna have to reinvent herself, use a different mix of pitches, set things up differently to try to keep them off balance.
Familiar look from Gabby Plain. Very talented Australian. Well, pops up the 2-2 pitch, also goes out of play. We'll select people, about 200 in attendance for all of these sessions. No tickets to the general public. And it's chilly. So as you can tell, people all bundled up.
We asked Heather Tarr about that. We said, is it cold there? She said, you know, it's just the wind. It just keeps blowing.
Nice block behind the plate by Flores. Ball in front of her, kind of damp too in Seattle. We've been very fortunate with the weather this weekend.
Typically you see a lot of raindrops falling, but all we've seen fall out of the sky is a bunch of cottonwood seeds that look like snow. So these overcast skies have kept the temperatures down, and the wind has been whipping through the stadium today.
Full count to Bump. Gabby Plain has allowed three base runners already in the first four batters she has faced.
A smile from Coach Hutch. Those are hard to come by, Pam. I mean, really, I love Coach Hutchins as a coach, but you have to earn those smiles. And so far, this start definitely deserves one.
Audrey LeClaire comes in. We saw her earlier tonight. She runs for Allen over at second base. Your attention, please. Your at second base. Number 21, Audrey LeClaire. Still just one away. Allen got on the RBI single that plated Blair, who led off the game with a single. Jimenez takes ball one. Matt Jacks behind the plate calling balls and strikes. It's a crucial game. Into right field, Willis retreats. Pinch runner tags at second and LeClaire into third. So runners on the corners now with two away.
A really deep drive, but Jimenez was pulling off that pitch. So the barrel dropped just a little bit, got under that one, drove it into the outfield. An advancement on it, so runners on the corners, but two outs kind of changes how you play that first and third situation.
From Espen. Espen the DP.
Slippery Snake is
out
there,
Pam. Slippery Snake finally making an appearance. The Snake was kind of snoozing in the first game. That's something that goes to players who make nice plays. Maxi Blair starting things off with a single, scoring a run, something they could not do in game one. Snake has been around for a couple of weeks.
Well, that performance definitely earns her the right to wear Slippery Snake around her neck.
Espen behind 0-2. Playing with the strikeout to end the inning, but they have been able to do in the first inning what they couldn't do in seven innings earlier tonight, and that score against Plain. Welcome back, heading to the bottom of the first inning in the regional championship that will decide who goes to the Super Regional. Michigan with a run in the top of the first inning, leading Washington now 1-0 as we take a look at the Washington starting lineup brought to you by Capital One. Morgan Flores having herself a heck of a weekend.
Yeah, 5 for 12, two home runs, and come at very pivotal times. Found herself trying to inch back against Michigan in the game yesterday. It was the only run of the game, but then coming up with another one in the last game. The first run of the game coming in the first inning, and that 2-0 win is what pushed us here to this if necessary game. Morgan Flores making a big difference in the lineup.
Megan Bobian got the ball in game one in Michigan with this potent 1-2 punch. Alex Duraco, who beat Washington yesterday, starts. Starts off against Sis Bates, who took a rare collar 0-for-3 in the first game today. Bates getting the bunt down. Bump, who's a really good defensive third baseman, pounces on it to get Bates. We saw her do that in the first game tonight.
Yeah, just trying to drop a little drag bunt, try to keep the defense on their toes. Bump crashed hard, grabbed it. Great play across the dish. And the thing that makes it difficult is you don't know how hard she's going to slap this ball. Comes away with a little soft slap, but bump over on third. Great defensive play. Gets the first out of the inning.
Yeah. Klingler, first pitch swinging, sends it into the corner and right. And Bailey with a stand-up one-out double.
Yeah, Klingler says, what do you mean you're going to highlight Flores? I do good things, too. She did have a hit in the last game, but this one into the right field corner. An outside pitch, drives it the other way. Look at that balance. Just gets great extension, letting the ball get deep. And really runs hard, making sure that it's a no-doubter into second base.
And their second hit of the day, had one against Urbian. And here's Flores, who you just highlighted in the lineup, has hit a solo home run in each of the two games against Michigan this weekend. Sends the 0-1 pitch skyward, and the diving attempt. Voss can't get it, and she's shaken up. Runners on the corners, but Voss face planted, trying to make that catch.
Just a scary moment out there in right field. You saw as she was running in, the ball just continued to drift and carry closer to the line. So it came off of the bat of Flores, who is a right-handed hitter. It's just a face plant into the ground. And Pam, we're not on site, but I believe that that's AstroTurf in the outfield. I don't know that that's real grass. Is it? It's grass, and so just really hard hit, tough dive in the outfield. Hoping that she's okay.
See, Coach Hutchins is out there along with Associate Head Coach Bonnie Thole, the athletic trainer Brian Boyles-White with the mask. Great attempt by Voss to try to get the softball.
So a dive on the play, comes away with the catch, but it comes out of the glove as Voss's face hits the ground. The second baseman Jimenez comes up with the ball, but just absolutely hard hit in the face. And the ball does not hit her. It's just her face making contact with the ground. You mentioned the trainer coming out to escort her off the field, make sure she's okay.
Got to be shaken up, and now Voss leaving the playing field. Now Michigan trying to calm things down in the circle after the Flores single. Klingler, who doubled, had to hold up to see if Voss was going to make the catch, so she only made it over to third. But runners on the corners with just one away. And that's
so
Sierra Kirsten. Get the defense set for you in a second. Lexi Blair is in center, and Sierra Kirsten, who just came in now, goes over to left. So here we go. So Lexi Blair goes from left to center. Haley Hogenrod goes from center to right for Voss. And Sierra Kirsten comes in to play left. So an outfield shift for everyone. Heather Tarr is out to speak to a member of the umpiring crew.
Just making sure she has all of those defensive changes correctly, because you do see some changes that don't get recorded correctly and they come back to haunt you later in the game. And with all of the ways that you can navigate a lineup, very smart of Tarr to be able to make sure that those changes are done correctly so that she can keep Michigan accountable later in the game.
So there's the shift, Hogenrod going from center to right, Lexi Blair from left to center, and Sierra Kirsten, who is a freshman utility player from Clarkston, Michigan, going into left. And Kirsten is known for her good defense. Now over in left field, and we're ready to start again. There's Sierra. So runners on the corners now. Just one away for Sammy Reynolds. Noelle He waiting on deck. Reynolds' first pitch swinging. Sends it to Kirsten, who just came into the game. Klingler tags and ties the game.
And just a quality at bat to come away with a deep fly ball out to left field. And Pam, I think the game knows when you come in the game fresh off the bench, the ball will always find you, it seems like. So Klingler does a really good job of just recognizing the ball being caught. It's deep enough. She doesn't have to worry about the play coming home, but a heads up play by Kirsten in left keeps the runner from advancing from first to second.
2 away for He, who takes a healthy cut. He a combined 0 for 4 in the two games against Michigan this weekend. Noelle had herself one heck of a game last night in a must-win situation. The 8-0 run rule win over Seattle. Home run and a double and 4 runs driven in. Straka goes upstairs again to strike her out, but Washington responds. Tie game after one. It's a 1-1 game as we head to the second inning. Final game of the Seattle region. Winner gets Oklahoma in the Super Region coming up later this week. Michigan in Ann Arbor. And during the shutdown, they had to do some creative things to stay in shape. And yes, in the wintertime, Jen, you wouldn't know this as a California kid. You got to do stuff in the snow.
Well, they had a 2-week pause in January. The health department shut down the team. So they had 2 hours to get their equipment from the field. They came in, they grabbed stationary bikes for the pitchers, soft nets for them to throw into. They had pitchers in their garages practicing with each other. They could not get together as a team. They had to train themselves, missed a lot of live at bats. And Coach Hutch's message to the team was, if you can pitch in your garage in Michigan in January, you can get out of any inning.
A lot of teams and a lot of sports had to get creative with various shutdowns, pardon me, as Hannah Carson leads things off here, the number seven hitter for Michigan. And that was a shutdown that went all the way across the athletic department, including the men's and women's basketball teams. And Michigan was supposed to have a big women's game against Maryland, and that was postponed while they shut things down. Atlee with the mistake.
And Pam, I know that that looks like a mistake because she's on the field with your favorite, Sis Bates, but honestly, that's a really tough play for a second baseman to make. Not only is she retreating and taking an angle that's back away from second base, but even if she fields that cleanly, her momentum is taking her away from that throw. That would be a really hard play to make, and because of that, that'll go down as a hit.
I am steeped in contrition right now. You were right. That was not a mistake. That was a single, not an error. Washington's a really good defensive team.
It's okay to say an error, because I think that Washington holds themselves accountable to that and knows that they can make a play that is hard like that. But knowing what it comes down to, you've got a great duo up the middle with Atlee and Bates.
Not bad defense up the middle. Bates over at short, three-time Pac-12 player or defensive player of the year. Carson on with the infield single. And this was Lexi Voss's spot in the lineup. And Kiki Thal coming in. Kirsten taking Voss's place. But now Kiki Thal coming in, who is the niece of associate head coach Bonnie Thal. He walked as a pinch hitter in the first game. And there's Aunt Bonnie.
And the recruiting process was different for Kiki, because she said, Coach Thal said, I didn't want to be the one evaluating her. So she brought in the other coaches to make sure she was seeing things through clear eyes, knowing that Kiki was valuable, but wanting it to be validated by the other heads of the staff.
And the other coaches saw her and said, yeah, let's bring her aboard. Grew up in Illinois, but a big Maize and Blue fan along with the rest of her family. Coach Hutchins, the head coach, in her 37th season. Morgan Flores behind the plate. And you know where Coach Hutchins went to college, right?
Michigan State.
Michigan State, the other side.
Yeah, the second most winningest coach in NCAA college softball history, just two wins behind Mike Candrea at Arizona.
Full protecting with two strikes. Michigan with three hits already. One more than they had in the entire first game today against Gabby Plain. Two hits, both of them by Blair. Flores coming out to speak with her pitcher.
It almost looks like she's getting a phone call from the dugout, doesn't it? She holds up her glove.
Yeah. Another 2-2 pitch on the way to Thal with Carson over at first base. Popped up and towards the football field, which is just behind the first base and right field line. That's the football practice field over the right field wall.
goes full.
Well, and I think what you're seeing is Gabby Plain recognizing when she was missing up in the zone, that's when she was vulnerable. And so a lot of these misses that we're seeing out of her hand tonight are down in the zones, filled the bottom of the zone with that drop ball early, but just keeping the ball down in the zone against these bigger hitters.
Pitch number 8 of this at bat, and that's a single, a pinch hit single for Thole. Runners at second and third with nobody out.
And we talked about how the ball had been down in the zone, but this one comes up, but it doesn't have that hard break that you're used to seeing out of the hand of Plain. Kiki Thole, her second quality at bat. Very good job getting on top of this one to line it over the head of Bailey Klingler down the line, and that's a double for Thole.
Second double of the season. Kiki now 5-for-16, playing in her 18th game. Worked the walk earlier today against Plain and doubled after seeing a lot of pitches from Plain. Bottom of the order, getting it done for Michigan. Single by Carson, double by Thole, and here is Hogenrod.
Well, and I love these conversations from Coach Hutch to her players. Willing to pass along quality information, and the coach and the players looking her in the eye, listening to what she has to say, and they step in the box with so much confidence, knowing that Coach Hutch believes in them.
Michigan doubling their hit total from game one tonight, now with 4 already. 4 different players. Rocco back there in the jacket, the starting pitcher for Michigan. Trying to keep warm on a chilly night. 0-2 to Hogenrod. Now the 1-2. It is well outside.
Well, and Hogenrod still looking for her first hit in this series. Is 0-5, had 2 strikeouts in the last matchup. Could not figure out Plain, was susceptible to the drop ball, also susceptible to the curve. So Hogenrod doing a good job of pulling this count even, but she's going to have to get the bat off the shoulder.
From 0-2 to a full count.
And that's a really good take. When that rise ball comes in at your eyes, it is so hard to lay off. You think you can catch up to it, but a really good hold to drive this count full.
Hogenrod struck out both times she faced Plain earlier today. None of those pitchers were close, were they?
No, and the strikes were, one was a check swing, but you still got the smirk out of Plain. But she is in a difficult spot with bases loaded, nobody out, and having to face the toughest hitter in this Michigan lineup.
Yeah, Lexi Blair has been Plain's kryptonite so far. 3 hits against her today, 2 in our earlier game, and then the leadoff single and scored back in the first inning. And already, Brooke Nelson is warming in the Husky bullpen.
And while nobody is as good as Gabby Plain on this pitching staff, they would definitely give Michigan a different look if they were to bring in one of these other arms out of the pen. Brooke Nelson, who's up in the pen right now, is kind of a velocity pitcher. But when we talk to Coach Heather Tarr about her, she says, you know, she just needs time to develop. Brooke Nelson only has 23 2/3 innings on the year. She is 2-0 in the circle, but her ERA, Pam, 6.80.
Huge difference in innings between Plain and the rest of the pitching staff. Very different from the co-number one, Starocco and Bobian for Michigan. And here's Blair, a huge opportunity in this game. All of a sudden, Plain can't find a strike. Big Ten Player of the Year against a finalist for National Player of the Year. Looking for her first hit with the bases loaded this season. Anna Carson led off with the single, now over at third. Kiki Thole with a pinch hit double, and then Hogenrod over at first after forcing or working a walk, I should say, off of Plain. Just nipped the outside corner.
And what we saw early was these Michigan hitters hitting early in the count, trying to take advantage of Plain trying to get ahead. And now what you're seeing, a little bit more discipline, making her bring the ball to them.
Three and one. Another full count after Blair fouled that away. Plain about to throw her 40th pitch. And we're only in the second inning, and there's nobody out.
Plain was not going to have an easy time with Blair sitting at the top of the lineup. She's been seeing the ball really well out of Plain's hand today. Came away with those two hits in the last one. But so far on this season, Blair has not been able to come away with a hit with bases loaded.
That's the sixth time she's come up with the bases loaded this season. It's off the glove of Adley. Bates picks it up. And a run crosses the plate.
Square a ball up and make things happen, especially putting the ball on the ground. That's when you make a defense really have to work. It's a ball left over more of the outside part of the plate. Blair gets around it, tries to push that ball to the other side of the field. It eats up Atlee. Bates able to come away with it so that there's no more damage done, but a really tough error over there by the second baseman.
Base is still loaded. They're credited with the run driven in. A walk, a double, a walk, and an error, reloading the bases for Natalia Rodriguez, who had a sack bunt back in the first inning. Two to Rodriguez. Pat Moore, who started last night, number 28 there on the right, and pitched a five-inning no-hitter against Seattle, has joined Nelson in the pen. Much needed strikeout for Plain.
It's just that nasty curveball. Not only does it nip the corner, but it continues to move away from these batters. So a really nice pitch. And Plain's able to dance around the zone when she's pitching from ahead. Really good strikeout for the first out of the inning.
It's the third time she's gotten Rodriguez today, twice in the earlier game and then that one, but here comes the power. Allen and bump. Lou, RBI single back in the first inning.
Well, you think that conversation that Bump had with Allen had to do with their home run numbers, Pam, because we know that they like to have that conversation, and right now Bump, the next hitter, has 12 on the year. Lou Allen comes in with 11, and she probably said, hey, just so you know, I'm ahead of you by one.
Yeah. Said that when they were playing Washington yesterday, and what happened? Well, back-to-back home runs with Allen and Bump. They were tied momentarily for the team lead.
Sheila Doughty Cornell on the left. She is the grandmother of Lou Allen. When it comes to softball prowess, that right there, that's a ton of experience. Two gold medals, played for Team USA in the 96 and 2000 Olympics.
Allen reaches out and places it into right field. And then the ball got away momentarily from Flores behind the plate. Allen with her second RBI single of the night. And that was on an 0-2 pitch.
Well, and you know that Gabby Plain is going to try to fill the zone early. But in an 0-2 pitch, that ball looked like it was in the other batter's box, Pam. Not only was that one off the plate, but Lou Allen did a really good job of extending, letting the ball get deep and not trying to do too much with it, pushing it in the outfield and getting another run.
Bases still loaded with one away for Taylor Bump. Pitch number 50 in the second inning. 50 overall, but coming in the second inning for Plain. Or is it 32? In just 32 this inning, pardon me. 50 overall. Yeah, 50 pitches in it. And you're still in the second inning. That's a ton. Especially for someone who already pitched a complete game today.
Taylor Bump has been on fire in this series. That's Carly Nance for Seattle U. She had an opposite field home run in that one. And then in the first matchup between Washington and Michigan, she went yard, power, pull side. I mean, there's a ton of power. She leads the team in home runs.
Michigan already with three hits with runners on base. They had none with runners on in the first game tonight. It was a 2-0 shutout. Much different story. And 3-1 on the way to Bump. Not close, forces in a run.
Well, not only is Bump showing that she has a really good eye, but I wonder if this Washington squad is pitching around her. That's her second consecutive walk. Now it does push into run, but when it comes to power, Bump is the one that you've got to stay away from. And so discipline at the plate forces another one around. And Pam, a much different look in this game as Michigan has the 3-run lead.
Just two hits in the first game, both by Blair. Four runs on five hits already in this one, and there's still just one away in the second. Menez has done a good job with the bases loaded this year. I'm gonna break this open early. Boy, with Starocco in the circle, you got to figure that Washington cannot afford to give up too many more runs. Another great play by Bates. Gets an out, but another run crosses the plate as Blair scores.
But look at how close the defense is playing in. Because of that, it takes away the ability to cover a lot of ground. But a heads-up dive by Bates gets the lead runner over there at third. Lou Allen is out. But just the defensive skills of Bates. Comes away with an out, but another run does score.
Fourth run of the inning. Warren Espen, the ninth Wolverine to bat in the second. Bump had to scramble to get back into second. Kirsten DPing for Espen. Came in when Voss left the game in the first inning when she face planted, trying to get a fly ball. Two-two pitch. Plain goes upstairs to get Kirsten, but boy, what an inning it was for Michigan as they plate four. It's 5-1 going to the bottom of the second.
This is the party that every player wants to be at.
It's going to be passionate softball for sure.
Back to crown a national champion for the first time since 2019. They get to chase history here.
Oh yeah, it's coming. June the 3rd, the Women's College World Series on ESPN. And now we can reveal, breaking news, the days and times for the Super Regional. Baton Rouge and UCLA will start on Thursday. And look at that, Oklahoma. We can announce that on Saturday, the Oklahoma site, either Washington or Michigan, that game is going to be on ABC. Huge.
That's the biggest news, perhaps, of the softball season. Recognizing its popularity, it gets a slot prime time on ABC.
Thursday and Friday, Super Regionals will split between starting there. The two starting Thursday will be Florida State at LSU and Virginia Tech at UCLA. Everybody else is going to get started on Friday. Arizona going to go to Arkansas. They eliminated Ole Miss. Kelly Lynch and Washington, boy, they have their work cut out for them. Down four, and yes, it's only the second inning, but they're going against a primo pitcher here. Alex Starocco, the unanimous selection for Big Ten Pitcher of the Year. Fifth in the nation in earned run average at .88. First in the nation in strikeouts per seven innings. And she's going out there with a four-run cushion.
Yeah, you're stealing all my nuggets about this pitcher in the circle, Pam. She's so good.
I can take the rest of the night off if you want.
No, please stay with me. I'll give you a couple more nuggets on this pitcher in the circle.
Okay.
She led the Big Ten in wins, ERA, and strikeouts, and had the complete game three hitter win over Washington yesterday. So very dominant, and showed she could be against this team already.
Right, Starocco trying to beat him for the second time in as many days. That travels far, but foul.
When it comes to strikeouts, yesterday she was able to use the top of the zone to get him out. A lot of swing and misses. Left the bat on the shoulder to use that screwball to keep it away. And no, that is not snow that you are seeing. That was the cottonwood seeds floating through the air. We're seeing a couple more here tonight, but definitely not as bad as it was yesterday. A little bit distracting for some of the plays that we saw going around the field. They were bunched up all over the field. Coach Tarr said she came out early this morning at 7 a.m. to clean up the field to make sure that they were not blown around today.
Three to the Lynch. Starocco with the complete game three hitter yesterday, the only blemish of the Flores home run. Allen and Bump with the solo shots off plane to win it for Michigan. That combination of Starocco had 13 strikeouts and only one walk in that game.
This is the kind of battle I've been expecting out of Lynch. She's been pretty quiet here in the postseason for Washington, but she's got some power in that bat. Five home runs on the year, led the team in home runs back in 2020 and the National Gatorade Player of the Year back in 2019.
also has done some pitching for the University of Washington. Tapper, bump, picks it up, not in time.
As a hitter, those feel like absolute junk coming off the edge of your bat. And it gets, you barely tap it, but because you don't get much of it, the defense seeing that that hit earlier in the at bat, the long home run, they respect your power, so they're back defensively. That's what gives her this base hit down the line in that nine pitch at bat.
Very good at bat for Lynch. A long foul ball down the left field line, and then the tapper that didn't go very far at all, but good enough to get an infield single. Stoyakov struck out Lynch twice yesterday. Leadoff single. Here's Taryn Attlee, the second baseman, up for the first time tonight. Fifth-year player, the Rutgers transfer. Brundage comes out to speak to her battery of Stoyakov and Hannah Carson.
So what you saw there was some discussion about, this is what it looked like, some positioning of holding the ball. So I don't know about what Heather Tarr was seeing, but as she's in the third base coach's box, she's able to see Stoyakov's holding of the pitch because of the opening of the glove to the third base side. And so you see her communicating back to the dugout, maybe a way to tip off the hitters as to what is coming as Stoyakov is pitching.
Heather Tarr was an outstanding Husky herself, three-time All-Pac-10 performer, played on a couple of World Series teams in the late 90s, including against Arizona.
So it's not necessarily off the hip, but as she puts it into the glove, they're trying to look at the positioning. Some pitchers find their pitches on their hip. Some pitchers find their pitches in their glove. But you'll notice she finds it quickly on her hip before she goes into her glove. And so as a hitter, you can pick up what it is the fingers are holding onto. So she's finding her seams, but then she grabs her pitch before she goes into her glove. So that's the pitch grip. As a hitter, you can pick that up. And sometimes it'll give you a hint as to what's coming in.
Attlee strikes out.
Yeah, set her up for this one really nicely. Has been using other pitches, but just up and over. But the grip on that one, is that the key that Heather Tarr is needing her pitchers to find before they attack that pitch that may be going up in the zone?
Sarah Willis up for the first time in this game. Lynch still over at first after the infield single to start things off in the second. ahead of Willis, 0-2, and that one just misses.
Wow, that was a really nice pitch. Scirocco with the smile knows that that one was one she wanted too. And Scirocco, remember, typically known as a curveball pitcher, but stretches the zone vertically with the rise and the drop. And the drop is the new pitch this year. So the rise ball, much more comfortable for her. And especially in tight situations like this game right here, you'll see her living in the top of the zone a little bit more.
Back-to-back strikeouts after the Lynch single. Women's College World Series is returning to Oklahoma City. Action begins Thursday, June 3rd at 12 Eastern. That's high noon on ESPN. For more information, go to NCAA.com, the official online home for all 90 NCAA championships. Super regionals falling into place now. Just two slots left to go. Alchin steps in. The winner of this game will play Oklahoma. Oregon and Texas have had all sorts of rain delays, and they have another game to play tonight in Austin. It'll be a super late night as that super regional spot is determined. The winner coming out of there will play Oklahoma State.
Yeah, I thought we were going to be the nightcap tonight, but weather pushing them beyond us. I will gladly hand over the award.
Yes, but they are in Atwell. You and I are in the Eastern time zone. They are in the Central time zone, I believe, right? Anyway,
well, this game is being played in Washington, so Pacific
yes.
time. So it's not late for them.
It's early, no.
Yep, and that Texas game is about to start, Pam, so.
Well, you know what, at this pace, I think that they could beat us to the finish. This game is moving at glacier speed. Only in the bottom of the second inning. ESPNU has that game if you want to watch both games at the same time, which would be perfect. And works the walk. We've already played over an hour and 5 minutes, and we're not even through two innings yet. Glacier speed.
Hey, we're creating landforms here.
So two on and two away, and to the top of the batting order, Sis Bates. Hitless so far, and first game against Michigan, and thrown out trying to bunt to get on in the first inning about an hour ago.
Beautiful changeup by Scirocco. She will throw that in any count. Just a great pitch to complement that curveball and rise ball that we see her living with right now.
Thank you. Now the 1-2 with two on and two away. Rocco against Bates. Bates just got a piece of that one to stay alive. Bates sends it into short left field. Kirsten grabs it. Washington down four after two. Welcome back to the NCAA Softball Regionals presented by Capital One. Gorgeous evening in Seattle. Take a look downtown for Puget Sound, Michigan with a 5-1 lead over Washington. The winner plays Oklahoma in the Super Regional, which starts on Friday. We remind you that there's Major League Baseball starting any minute now. Wait, it's Monday at 8 p.m. Eastern time. It's the two Central Division leaders in the National and American League, respectively, St. Louis and the White Sox. Sis Bates throws out.
In a second inning that seems to take forever, a great quick out for Washington.
On one pitch, Gabby playing through 42 pitches in the second inning. Scirocco just threw 30. And on one pitch, Carson is retired. Madison Husky in right. Now for Washington. Ricky Thole had a pinch hit double back in the second inning, staying in. The number eight slot in the batting order. Scored in part of a four-run second. Gabby pitching three games. A couple of shutouts. The 2-1 loss to Michigan yesterday. And as you can see, five runs in just two innings.
When we talked to Coach Bonnie Thal about Kiki, she said, you know, don't say on national TV that she's my favorite. I have a lot of great nieces and nephews. But after that last hit, I'm going to say she probably edged out the competition a little bit.
Yeah. At least for this evening, absolutely, when you can come up with a pinch hit double. Two pitch on the way. And Gabby starting to look like the pitcher we have seen for most of this season.
Well, and she was not getting this call earlier. She was keeping the ball down and away from most hitters. It's the curveball that just continues to cut across, but that looks like a drop ball. It just falls off the table over there on the outside part of the plate. A really good pitch and two outs in the inning.
Number nine hitter Haley Hogenrod walked and scored in the last inning. Still looking for her first hit of the weekend. Atlee flips it over, an 8-pitch inning for Plain, but her team's down 4.
Michigan lost the first game and went on to win the next two to win the championship.
Big season in 2005, the 65 wins, most wins ever, 32-game winning streak, defeated a number one ranked team for the first time. And who, what team was that?
UCLA.
Arizona. Arizona.
Well, and you got to give a nod to some of the players on that national championship team. Jessica Merchant had 21 home runs. Samantha Finley, that was her 21st home run as well. They had 103 home runs as a team, Pam. Just so much firepower. 419 runs on the season and a combined ERA for Jenny Ritter and Laurelyn Wilson of .95.
Haley Klingler sends one deep into the night. Foul. Oh. And traveled a long way towards Lake Washington.
But look at the separation she gets. When she gets down to toe touch with that front foot, the knob is back, loaded, ready to explode, and has great sequential. Great sequence as she goes from hips to hands through that.
And then Klingler sticks right with it on the next pitch and gets a base hit.
Well, a good hitter is always able to replicate a good swing. And so as she takes knee to hands, then they separate and then just drives that barrel right to the ball, pushes it into the outfield for a base hit to lead off the inning.
Klingler hitting .500 for the regional, 2-for-2 tonight at a double back in the first inning. And now starts off the third with a single. Morgan Flores, two home runs, both of them against Michigan pitchers. Got Starocco in the loss yesterday, Bobian in the win earlier today. So Heather Tarr in the dugout, not in the third base coaching box.
And so she's communicating with her players as to what they're seeing as well when they're in the box. So a very valuable piece, you know, for her to be able to sit in the dugout, talk to some of these senior leaders, and be able to say, here's what I'm seeing too.
Sis Bates. Right in front of her. So you don't have to have someone in the third base box, but you think Heather's gonna go sprinting out there like Usain Bolt if Klingler starts to come around and needs some guidance on the base paths.
It's late at night, so it's probably not going to be like Usain Bolt, but she'll probably hustle out there. Now, she'll have to go in between pitches. She's not allowed to leave the dugout during a play. She'll have to make sure she establishes where she needs to be before a pitch is thrown.
Two-two pitch on the way to Flores. Klingler with the leadoff single here in the bottom of the third inning. Rocco with the yell after the strikeout of Flores.
Yeah, we know that she is a really emotional pitcher in the circle, but that's a really big strikeout, knowing how dominant Flores has been against Michigan. A big changeup way ahead of it. Really nice pitch, and you saw the emotion out of pitching coach Jen Brundage coming out of the dugout, too.
Big out for Sirocco. Now Sammy Reynolds. Again, not your typical cleanup hitter. No home runs, not a lot of pop in the bat. Does hit for average, even though she's struggling so far in this regional. Coach Risley, now Tarr is out there. Runners on the corners, or actually runners now at second and third, pardon me, as Reynolds got all the way to second.
Well, and this swing is not meant to really do much with the ball, but it finds the perfect spot. It's a slap that gets all the way to the wall. Without a third base coach, Klingler had to do her own coaching. So you notice her head on the swivel trying to figure out where the ball was and could she advance. She holds herself up at third. But now Heather Tarr back in the third base coach's box to be able to navigate these Washington Husky runners.
Klingler leading off of the single, Flores strikeout, and then the Reynolds double. So second and third were just one away. Washington trying to chip away at this four-run advantage for Michigan. Winner goes to the Super Regional to play Oklahoma. That starts on Friday. Hit he to load the bases.
And a pitch that just gets away from Sirocco. It doesn't hit the arm guard of he. It actually hits her in the back arm, a very vulnerable spot. Ooh, that hurts. That is not a good way to take first base, but it loads them up for Washington.
Oh. And he was hit by a pitch by Bobian in the first game against Michigan today and gave Bobian a little bit of a look.
A little stare down.
Now Starocco gets her. And a pinch runner going over there. Sheely. Megan Bobian. Pitched in game one. Scored up five hits, two runs, only one of them earned. Michigan could not score against Gabby Plain, and now Kelly Lynch. Bases loaded, one away. Right down the heart of the plate. Bailey Klingler over at third, single to start things off. Sammy Reynolds doubled. And now Sheely, the pinch runner in for he who was hit by a pitch. It's your first time up. Saw nine pitches and got an infield single to start off the second inning. And Bobian quickly, we just saw her in the dugout. Now warming up. Lynch, solid base hit. Couple runs come in to score. And then taking the extra base. The pinch runner Sheely now at third. Now Washington cuts into the lead.
Kelly Lynch had a hit in her last at bat, but it was a topped ball that barely got away from the plate. This was a hard hit ball, absolutely squared up into left field. And remember, Sierra Kirsten was not the starter in left field. So that ball was not played very aggressively coming in. The throw home a little bit late. So Klingler able to score. Also Reynolds coming around from second base, another run as well, and the pinch runner Sheely able to advance all the way over to third base.
So credit Kelly Lynch with the RBI single, who advanced to second on the throw home. Two run single for Lynch. Sheely now at third, Lynch at second. Eight runs and 11 hits between these two teams. After a 2-1 and then 2-0 score the first two times they played, Lily Agin in to run for Lynch.
I really like that pinch runner for Washington. She ran, Lily Agin ran track very, just extremely fast. So really good base runner out there at second with just one out.
Bottom of the order now, Taryn Atley struck out swinging her last time up. Heather Tarr told us earlier that she's a clutch hitter. She said, I don't care about her average. Always seems to come up with big hits. Washington could sure use one now, but Atlee is down 0-2. Pops out to the second baseman, Jimenez. Out number two. Madison Husky coming in for Willis. To play right field and the last half inning stays in to hit for her.
That is a devastating changeup. Just, that's a game changer. So much speed change, drops it in for a strike. We're seeing these Husky hitters trying to be aggressive early in counts. That's a great way to lead off the at bat.
Down 0-2.
And we've seen Alex Draco, starter, with a changeup go up in the zone for strike two. In her last at bat, Sarah Willis struck out on the changeup. Will Husky fall prey to that pitch as well?
It's the second at bat for Husky in this regional. It's a big one. And it's DeRocco. Gets the pinch hitter to strand a couple of runners.
An amazing curveball that just continues to trail out her fourth strikeout of the game.
On to the top of the fourth inning, Washington trailing Michigan 5-3. Winner goes to the Super Regional, joined now by head coach Heather Tarr. And coach, that last half inning, something I haven't seen very often. You weren't in the third base box going over into the dugout. What was that all about?
Well, I kind of got stuck in there, and then I'm like, all right, well, maybe I won't need to be needed until runner gets at second. And then the runner wasn't at second. And then I was like, oh, I guess I'm needed. So there was a good time to get out there, and then I had to get out there.
That's right. Well, when it comes down to it, we've seen Gabby playing a bunch. We know that you'll ride her arm in the postseason. What is it about her that just gives you so much confidence?
Yeah, I think that second inning was a little rare, you know. It just kind of didn't go our way, and they put up a big number there. But, you know, she's going to keep us in this game, and if we don't think she will, then we're going to go to the next one.
All right, Coach, and hello to
Yeah, we got to say hi to Artie Tarr. Hi, Mom.
There you go. Thanks so much. Yep, her mom watching along with her brother Josh. And there's Sis Bates, Klingler, and the cutout on the left. That is her mom Artie. The cutout on the right, her late dad Vic. Big supporters. Grew up in Sammamish, Washington. Went to UW. I believe the locals call it that. If I was in Seattle, I could ask a local that.
That's right.
Here we go. Gabby Plain in the circle. Lexi Blair starting things off. Singled and scored in the first. Reached on an error and scored in the second. Coach Tarr talk about that second inning. It really was very un-Gabby Plain-like. Threw 42 pitches. Four runs came in to score. Washington scratching back for two hits in the bottom of the third to get back to within two.
And this is the kind of battle you would expect out of these two teams, knowing that this is a win-or-go-home situation. This is the only way to extend your season. You've got to win this one to be able to go against Oklahoma in the Super Regionals.
Ooh, that pitch off the plate runs the count to 3-1. Hutchinson being positive over there in the third base box.
Well, she's continued to coach her players throughout this game. We've seen her pull players aside, give them those specifics about staying in their legs or picking out a pitch they want to hit. I mean, just I love how intense and how invested she is in each and every single hitter.
Michigan. Yep, it's just the powerhouse of the Big Ten, right? It's like Minnesota won it in 2017, and that broke up a long string.
Yeah, Michigan has won 12 of the last 13 Big Ten championships. Three in a row coming into this one. Lexi Blair needing to start things off. They need a little bit more cushion to feel comfortable going through the end of this one.
Klingler drifting over. That is a big out. Blair is so tough to get out. First time they've gotten her tonight. Super Regionals coming your way. We have some matchups for you. We start planning some stuff coming up. The winner of this goes to Oklahoma. That gets underway on Friday. James Madison among those unseeded teams to get through. Texas and Oregon scoreless in the third in that decisive game.
Yeah, I'm interested in seeing that JMU Missouri matchup.
Rodriguez beats it into the ground to Klingler. Quick two outs.
If you'll remember back, Missouri was deemed ineligible for the postseason back in 2020, but JMU coming away with the unseeded victory over Tennessee in Knoxville. So JMU advancing out of the Knoxville Regional will head to Missouri to play the Tigers. Just seem to be on a roll right now, proving a point that they deserve to not have that penalty against them back in 2020.
Llewellyn has a pair of RBI singles. You know, Larissa Anderson really doing a good job in Missouri rebuilding that program. UCLA Virginia Tech on the other side of the bracket, intriguing to me. How about Keely Rochard going up against Rachel Garcia?
Yeah, will those UCLA hitters be able to attack the number one pitcher coming out of the ACC?
Rochard leading the country in strikeouts. Gabby Plain, number two in the circle for Washington. Super Regionals getting underway on Thursday, and then a week from Thursday, the World Series starts. Sheila Cornell is the grandmother of Lou Allen, bundled up, getting chilly as it heads towards 10 o'clock Pacific time.
Well, maybe some of you at home may not understand why that name, Sheila Cornell, is a big deal. Well, she was on the first ever United States Olympic team, has herself two gold medals playing in Columbus, Georgia in 96, and then also in the 2000 Olympics, coming away both of those two gold medals.
Another full count.
So cool to be able to have a grandma that you can look up to in that way. I mean, you see a lot of grandmothers mentoring their grandchildren, but when it comes to this one, she's able to do it in a much more personal way as they both play the same sport. And it's kind of neat because across the diamond, Washington able to have Heather Tarr on the Olympic coaching staff this year.
Gabby Plain got her looking. First one, or the second in a row, 1-2-3 inning for Plain. Starting to settle in. Welcome back to Seattle, middle of the fourth inning. 5-3, Michigan leading Washington. Winner take all goes to the Super Regional. We are joined now by Carol Hutchins, the head coach for the Wolverines. And coach, very different from what we saw earlier today. What do you think the difference was against Plain, particularly in that second inning?
You know, the kids are fighting hard, and you know, we had a little reset at halftime, and our kids are giving us all they got. They've been outstanding, and they're just fighting their hearts off.
Well, and it's so fun to see Starocco just dealing in the circle. What kinds of tips are you giving to your hitters? We see you talking to them in between each at bat.
Well, we're trying to stay behind the ball and lift it, and I think Gabby Plain has made some adjustments and thrown a little more in, and you know, it's a game. It's a game within the game, and adjustments, we just need to keep making them, and I'm sure they'll keep making them.
All right, Coach, again, thank you so much.
Thanks for being here.
All right, Coach Hutchins, and there's, yep, uh-huh. Kind of relate to that response out in the field. Natalia Rodriguez with an All-American yawn out there at shortstop. And seriously, all you folks on the East Coast, I know a lot of Michigan fans are watching. It's late in Michigan. It's 1:03 a.m. And you're up watching your maize and blue. First pitch swinging. And that leaves the building. Jadelyn Archin with her sixth home run of the season makes it a one-run ball game.
Alchin lights this one up. Her first hit of the regional came in the last game, and this one tattooed left big. Great turn on that pitch, celebrated in the outfield. Look at the fans, so happy to have them here in the ballpark. Very quiet bottom half, just throws her hands right at it, gets her backside through that ball. Great hit. And Pam, we're now, this game, a one-run ball game.
Yeah, it was 5-1. Heading into the bottom of the third. Two runs in the third, and then the solo shot. The first pitch that Alchin saw from Starocco. Gabby Plain has retired 8 straight Wolverines after really struggling, especially in the second inning that we mentioned. And team is scratching back. And Starocco will give way to the other ace, Megan Bobian.
Bobian threw in the last one. She threw that complete game. We'll see her back in the circle here for this one. Gives it a little different look from the left side. She throws in the upper 60s, stays up in the zone with a curve, a screw, and a rise. But as a hitter, you have to always be aware of the changeup. Bobian did not throw it as much in the last game as we would expect, but she will throw it in any count, even when behind. So I expect to see her mixing that pitch in a little bit more here in this outing. Another big moment for Washington. Bottom half stays really quiet, toe touch, not very aggressive, but does a really good job of just exploding her hands right into that pitch, stays with her head behind the ball, drives that one deep in a one-run ball game now because of it.
Seventh hit of the game for Washington. 3 of them have been for extra base hits. It's the first home run. And now Sis Bates comes up for the third time, 0 for 2 against the starter Starocco. And was 0 for 3 against Bobian in the first game these two teams played today. Three hits away from tying Sarah Pickering for the most in the history of Washington softball.
There's that changeup. That's the one that, it's just a floaty change. It spins quick, it sits high in the zone, and then just falls off down into the zone. You think it's gonna just float in at the chest and be a ball, but a really good changeup by Bobian.
Chopped, Bates just beats it out. Jimenez had a little bit of a hiccup trying to get rid of the ball quickly.
Sis Bates just does so much with the bat, just a surgeon as she navigates what she's gonna do. You see her drop bunts there, pushing a slap to the second baseman. And just that teeny little bobble is all it takes to allow Sis Bates to get down the line. Pushing through that one, gets the safe call and the emotion. That's the tying run over there on first base.
Bates going full out all the time. And that was ruled an infield hit for Bates. Now 2 away from tying Pickering for the most hits in Washington history. Ringler in her second season at Washington. First team all Pac-12, the first with 50 runs and 50 runs driven in for Washington since Ali Aguilar back in 2017. Very dangerous, has power. But down 0-2 to Bobian.
And Klingler's been on fire in this game. She's a perfect 2 for 2, a double in that first at bat. And here in the regional, she's 7 for 14. So That last outing in the last game, she was 1-for-4, so not typical for her, and now coming in much hotter in this win or go home game.
Tremendous numbers for the junior from Houston. Lindler sends it into center field, hits at the base of the wall, and Sis Bates ties the game, scoring all the way from first.
Bailey Klingler, the transfer in from Texas A&M, comes away with a really big hit to tie this one up. We've seen her be really susceptible to that pitch up in the zone. Well, Bobian takes it right back up there into what is her wheelhouse, up, and she goes to get it. That's a pitcher's pitch up in the eyes of Klingler, but it gets all the way to the outfield. That is her third double in this regional. A hard slide for Sis Bates. Calls herself safe on the ground. And Pam, this one's all tied up.
How about that? Washington down 5-1. Two runs in the third. Now two here in the fourth. And now Flores will be put on with first base open.
So while that is Bailey Klingler's 17th double of the season, that is the third double for Washington here in this game.
Klingler has two of them. Flores has hurt Michigan with the long ball this weekend. And Sammy Reynolds, we talked about it all weekend, not your typical power cleanup hitter. They're going to take their chances with Reynolds. Still nobody out. Martin started things off with a home run off Starocco, the starter who left, and Bobian came in. Infield single by Bates, the RBI double you just saw by Klingler, and now Flores with the intentional walk. Brings Jen Brundage out. Rocco started, now back in the dugout. And remember, as the starter, she can come back in and pitch. Bullpen is empty. Just to correct myself, Reynolds actually with power with 11 home runs, but shows slap a lot of times. Just a very interesting, different kind of cleanup hitter, but does have the power. Tied for, right behind Flores, pardon me, and Klingler for the team lead. It's in the regional where she doesn't have any home runs, so my apologies.
Well, and that's the thing about these Washington hitters. They hit from the left side, and so they open up a lot of different opportunities for how they can be successful. We see Sis Bates at the top dropping drag bunts, but she's also got, you know, a home run on the year. So there's power and speed and a lot of different tools that these Washington hitters are able to use.
Boy, what a game this has been. Playing to keep their season alive and go to the Super Regional in Norman. Oklahoma scored 24 runs to eliminate Wichita State earlier today. Pitching has shown some vulnerabilities, but boy, their hitting is almost unparalleled. Now a 3-1, and there's the bunt. Reynolds gets it down, and it's dropped over at first by Jimenez. Everybody's safe.
Well, Pam, tell me how many teams in the nation have a number four hitter with 11 home runs that has that kind of speed and the ability to drop a drag bunt. That is crazy. What an amazing tool that Washington has, and it's misplayed over there at first base by the second baseman Jimenez as she crashes over to cover while the corners went in to field that ball.
Error on Jimenez loads the bases.
And what I think Washington was trying to do there was just take advantage of an emotion-filled moment where there had been some miscues going on. But typically when you turn to square with bases loaded, you want to push that bunt a little bit farther because your corners are crashing so far and you want to try to get it past those aggressive corners. But Michigan plays that really well for the first out.
With one away, here's Kelly Lynch. A couple of hits, including a two-run single the last time she was up. Down 0-2, bases still loaded with one away. That's Starocco, who started the game and then was lifted after giving off a leadoff home run in this fourth inning. Looking on as Bobian has had trouble. Throw home and not in time. Jimenez decided to gamble and try to get the force at home instead of the short out at first, and it cost them the lead.
And it's a force play at home, but it takes the second baseman Jimenez into that 3-4 hole. So the catcher needed to make sure that she was front or back foot at the front of the plate rather than back foot at the back of the plate. That might have made all the difference. She would have been a little bit closer to receiving that throw, stretching like a first baseman, but Carson set up at the back of the plate on that one.
The bases are still loaded with one away for Atlee. 0 for 2 so far in this game tonight.
But look at Carson as she sets up on it. Her right foot is at the back of the plate, which takes her maybe a foot or two deeper to receive that throw. If she gets that right foot at the front of the plate and then stretches for it, there's the possibility that that could have been an out at home.
Atlee takes the 0-2 just off the outside corner. The eighth Husky to bat in this fourth inning. First two games these teams played in the Seattle region were pitchers' duels. This is turned into, at times, chaos. Very different than the first couple of games. A lot of scoring. Long innings. Atlee in the air, and that's going to find the grass. Another run comes home for Washington.
Well, and Pam, how did this inning start? It started with the home run by Alchin sitting in the nine spot. It got Bobian a little rattled, I think, and what you're seeing is this Washington team fighting back from the loser's bracket, trying to advance to the Super Regionals.
Washington has scored six straight runs in this game after falling behind 5-1 in the second inning. And still just one away. Rocco and Probian struggling. That's over the head of Blair. Two more runs cross the plate. Madison Husky coming up big.
And this pitch gets deep in the swing. It's an outside pitch. She hits it out to right field over the head of Haley Hogenrod, who is in right field, not doing too much with their bottom half right now. Washington staying very quiet in their legs, but goes all the way to the wall. And remember, that is not your starting right fielder. The outfield was moved around as Voss was taken from the game after hitting her head on the ground. So right now, Washington taking advantage of some Michigan miscues.
Two-run double for Husky, who did not start this game. Husky at second, Atlee at third. And yes, Washington has batted around in the fourth inning. Alchin got things started with the home run off Starocco, who then was lifted, and since then, Bobian has only gotten one out, while five more runs have scored. Yeah.
Oh, and how did this inning start? Well, Starocco was in the circle. Alchin, the number 9 hitter, was up to bat, and she took Starocco deep. Great hit for her second home run of the year.
Just struck out swinging for the second out. Second time we've seen Bates in this inning. She beat out an infield single. Keep the line moving for this Washington Husky team. Washington in this game now as a team is 11 for 22. Six of those 11 hits, extra bases. There she goes again, no way. No chance. Atlee scores run number 10.
And while Sis Bates has power, she's been using the short game in her last couple at bats. The first baseman, Lou Allen, read the ball wrong, and because of that, Taylor Bump had to come all the way in from third to pick that ball up. Lou Allen retreated to first base, which made that slot over there on the right side very vulnerable. Sis Bates, a smart hitter, recognized that and got another run for Washington.
Klingler with an RBI double earlier in this inning. Washington scoring 7 runs on 7 hits in this inning alone against 2 of the best there are, you know, out there with Starocco and Bobian. Part of the pitching staff with the best ERA in the country. Rodriguez finally ends it. Well, what an inning it was for Washington. They played 7 and lead by 5.
What an inning for Washington. They're able to grab a 5-run lead. A huge 4th inning, 7 runs, and they find themselves on top.
Welcome back to the NCAA Softball Regionals presented by Capital One. Oh my goodness, what a night in Seattle. A beautiful view from the Space Needle. And I don't even know how you explain this game right now as Washington leads Michigan 10-5. That just came out of a 7-run, 7-hit, 4th inning. We're down 5-1 and they flipped the script. It's now 10-5. Gabby Plain, more reason to smile. Pam Ward along with Jenny Dalton Hill. And what a way to end this regional that started kind of in chaos with the controversial underseeding of both Washington and Michigan. And now it's finishing with this.
Well, both of these teams feeling like they needed they had something to prove. But it comes away with just some crazy offensive performances, and Washington falling into the loser's bracket because of their loss to Michigan yesterday, but now looking to, they won the first one here and pushed the if necessary.
Taylor Bump on a 2-0 pitch starts things off in the 5th inning by going the opposite way. She's been on all 3 times tonight against Gabby Plain, who earlier today won her 31st game of the year. About to throw her 85th pitch. 42 of them, half of those 84 pitches came in the second inning.
both of these teams typically have a very quick pace. But this game, because of all of its scoring and pitching change, we've seen this one become a real testament to what these teams are fighting for as they both have their backs up against the wall trying to advance.
Jimenez comebacker, playing a little bit high, but handled by Bates, and they turn the double play.
We talked with Gabby Plain about how she feels with Sis Bates playing defense behind her. She said, whenever there's a ball, I know that she's going to be able to handle it. Well, this one, a great double play because of the feed that Gabby Plain was able to give her over there at second base.
And Gabby Plain fields her position very well. We've seen a ton of comebackers to her during the weekend. And that erased Bump, who got on with the infield single. Sis Bates, the defensive national player of the year, is voted on by a committee of me.
I think our production crew was on that train as well. I'm sure her mom and dad agree. And actually, with how many highlight reels she's been on and web gems she's had, definitely a unanimous vote. But that way, Washington able to get out of it, still with a 5-run lead.
The NCAA Softball Regionals is presented by Capital One. What's in your wallet?
Oh, Seattle, Washington, gorgeous, even when the sun is down. As you're looking over Puget Sound towards downtown, we are north of town, still in Seattle, but north of downtown in the campus of the University of Washington, and look at that line score. A lot of crooked numbers. 10 runs on 12 hits for Washington. Flores leading things off. Tenth time Washington has scored double-digit runs this season. They're in the top 15 in the nation in batting average. Remember, this is the team that finished second to UCLA in the Pac-12. Flores sends it towards the wall, and it's gathered in by Hogenrod to start the fifth. Washington batted around in the fourth inning, in which they scored 7 runs. Being in the circle, starting her first inning after coming in with, after one batter hit a home run in the beginning of that wild fourth. Lexi Voss, sunglasses on in the dugout in the first inning while pursuing a fly ball, took a scary face plant into the ground, left the game. Do not have an update, but good to see her in the dugout.
And they took her directly off the field to evaluate her right away, but so good to see her back in the dugout with her team.
Sophomore from Illinois, part of the platoon used in the outfield by Michigan, and this is it.
Well, and when you dive in the outfield on grass, there's a lot of times what happens is your bottom half gets stuck, and sometimes the top half can just hit with a ton of force. And so you saw her head hit the ground really hard. She came out of the game. We do not have an update on her condition, but just really grateful that she's back in the dugout.
Haley Hogenrod took over for Voss in right field. She had been the starting center fielder. Lexi Blair went from left to right, and Sierra Kirsten came in to play left where Blair originally started. So it was a big change in the outfield for Michigan when Voss went out in the first inning. Sammy Reynolds has doubled, reached on an error, and scored a couple of runs. Handled by Bump in foul territory for the second out. And that fourth inning was a wild one. Started off with the option home run, and then Starocco was lifted for Bobian, and then it just went crazy. Here's Sheely, who came into the game and hitting for He now. I mean, it just all kind of broke loose in that seven-run inning. They coming back from a 5-1 deficit, and now lead by five. The winner gets Oklahoma on Friday. Remember, the Super Regionals are best of three.
And they've changed that format, so now it's one game per day. That one will start Friday, go Saturday, and then Sunday if needed.
It used to be you would play one game, and then the if necessary game would be part of a doubleheader on day two. Starocco, who started the game, looking on in the dugout for the Big Ten champions. He was the unanimous Big Ten Pitcher of the Year this season. Sheely runs well and is able to beat it out. That has been ruled a single for Olivia Sheely. Ellie Lynch having a good night. You mentioned that she'd struggled at the beginning of this regional. Bat starting to come alive.
Well, and Sheely came in for Noelle He, who had been hit in the wrist. We have not seen He again since that. She was lifted for Sheely as a pinch runner, and Sheely has stayed in the game ever since.
Lynch went down and got it. It travels quite a ways for Blair to grab it to end the inning, stranding Sheely. 10-5 after five. Welcome back to the NCAA Softball Regionals presented by Capital One. Seattle, Washington. Only two spots remain for the Super Regionals. Texas is up 1-0 on Oregon in the bottom of the sixth inning in Austin. Wait, bottom of the fifth inning, pardon me. That game's on ESPNU. You are watching ESPN2. Pam Ward and Jenny Dalton Hill joining you. Washington up 10-5. Gabby Plain trying to win her second game of the day against Michigan. Washington in a winner go home game earlier today that started almost 6 hours ago. Playing a rocky, really rocky second inning as Michigan leads off the top of the sixth with Hannah Carson, the catcher. Singled and scored and part of that four-run second inning in which Gabby Plain threw 42 pitches.
Thank you.
Half a dozen strikeouts for Plain. Flores threw down to Lynch to complete it to start the sixth inning. For the Michigan seniors, including Megan Bobian, Taylor Bump has been so huge for them as a power hitter. And the word from University of Michigan's Sports Information Department, because of the COVID year last year, all these seniors have graduated, but some of them still have some eligibility left, but no definitive decisions have been at least released as to who or who might not come back, but certainly some careers will end tonight. The 10 champs sent all the way to Seattle, by far the farthest. Another comebacker to Plain.
Well, and that was how
a
she,
dozen of those, right?
Right, and it's, when I'm thinking back on it, it was the last game, the first game of the day, that she just rolled a ton of ground balls. She was able to get a lot of the outs herself. This game has been a little bit more eventful. We've seen a rocky second inning for Gabby Plain, and then a really rough fourth inning for Megan Bobian.
Hoganrod being pinch hit for right now.
When Thais was on that list of seniors that was up for Michigan, you wonder if this is a nod by Coach Hutch to be able to give her an at-bat here if Michigan is unable to respond. This may be her last at-bat of her career if they're unable to pull up a win.
Ace Gonzalez, 3-for-27 on the year. Thais, a grad student from Boca Raton, Florida. Since that rough second inning for Plain, she has faced the minimum amount of batters, did allow a single in the last inning, but was erased in the next batter with a double play. Boy, Plain really has responded well. A couple more strikeouts in that inning. Washington three outs away now from the Super Regional. Let's take a look at tonight's Capital One rewarding performance. It's not a human being, it's an inning.
It started off with the Jaylen Alchin home run. That started things off, and then a Bailey Klingler double. Scored some more. Sis Bates coming across. Then down at the bottom of the lineup, Taryn Attlee with a hit. Scored some more. Husky, another double. And then Sis Bates. Oh, there's the double.
That's Husky.
Yep. And then the infield hit by Sis Bates, the drag bunt, to push another run in. That fourth inning was a wild one. Seven runs plated by Washington and a five-run lead.
12 Huskies came to the plate in that inning. Seven runs on seven hits. Starocco lifted at after the home run to start things off, and then Bobian came in. And that's when things really, really became chaotic. Bump throws down, not in time to get Atlee. Calling her for being.
Yeah, we've noticed that slappers are just still very vulnerable to the out-of-the-box call. If they make contact with the ball, whether fair or foul, check out the left foot as it steps across. Ooh, Pam, that's a tight one, especially late in the game. And those batter's box lines are a little bit blurred. That's a tough call. That call is made by the home plate umpire. It can also be made by the second base umpire with a four-man crew. So, but that's definitely a borderline call here at the end of the game with those lines very blurred. So she's making contact with the ball, but it's definitely difficult to tell where that left foot is. Is it out of the box or not? I mean, any part of the foot outside that line, but Pam, it's hard to tell where is the defined line as we sit here at the end of this game.
So take the infield single away from Taryn Atlee. Here's Madison Husky. We just showed you her two-run double in that fourth inning. If Washington holds on to win, there will be three Pac-12 schools in the Super Regionals. Husky pops out. Arizona going to play Arkansas. That should be interesting.
That'll be a great matchup. Courtney Dyfel, the head coach for Arkansas, won a national championship at Cal, and then heading against the perennial powerhouse of Arizona, and Coach Candrea's 8 national championships.
And then UCLA, Virginia Tech. We already talked about the Rachel Garcia, Keely Rochard matchup in the circle. Alchin got things started in that sixth inning with the home run and struck out subsequently. University of Washington, they can hold on to this 5-run lead. We'll be getting on a plane to Norman, Oklahoma, and one of those games in that Super Regional going to be on ABC. Good going. Popped up, and Lou Allen grabs it to end the inning. Last chance coming up for the Wolverines, top of the order.
This is the party that every player wants to be at.
It's going to be passionate softball for sure.
Back to crown a national champion for the first time since 2019.
They get to chase history here.
And the chase begins a week from Thursday, noon Eastern time on ESPN, the Women's College World Series presented by Capital One back in Oklahoma City. Seattle, Washington, where the Huskies are 3 outs away from going to Norman, which is near Oklahoma City, to take on the number 1 overall seed Sooners. Gabby Plain trying to beat Michigan for the 2nd time tonight. Washington thrust into the loser's bracket by losing to Michigan yesterday, 2-1. Plain came back, shut them out earlier today, fell behind 5-1. 9 unanswered runs by the Huskies. But here's the top of the order, Lexi Blair. It's going to fall foul. Really electric player for this Michigan Wolverine team. This regional that started with controversy with Washington, the walking out of the selection show when they were announced as the 16th seed. Coach Tarr said the players were talking about what to do when their name was finally announced. Somebody said, hey, let's just get up and walk out. They did just that. Feeling as the number two team in the Pac-12, a top five team, they should have gotten a better seed. Atlee throws out Blair for the first out.
After watching 60 other teams be brought up on the screen and also two other Pac-12 schools be seeded higher than them, even though they finished second in the Pac-12, they just felt like they had been really disrespected. And so instead of sitting and listening to the rest of the show, they got up and she said, we just got to work.
And they have had to work hard to scratch back in this. And both Coach Tarr for Washington, Coach Hutchins for Michigan, talked about how it was unfair for the other team. Michigan is the Big Ten champ, not even seeded at all. Coach Tarr harkening back to 2017 when Minnesota was the Big Ten champ. They were unseeded, got sent to Alabama. They were thinking they were going to host a regional. Au contraire, they had to go to Tuscaloosa. And Alexis Osorio, it was 2-1-0 shutouts. It was an amazing regional. I mean, that was a regional matchup.
Well, and that's what's so disappointing is both of those teams so deserving of being in Oklahoma City, but one of them negated the opportunity because of that matchup before it was even a possibility.
Yeah, before it was even a super regional. Natalia Rodriguez. You take away Gabby Plain's disastrous 42-pitch second inning. It's been pretty efficient, right? Just over 60 pitches in the other almost six innings now for the unflappable Aussie.
Well, and we've seen her under the century mark for a lot of her outings, just very efficient in the circle, fills the zone, gets the swing and miss. Tons of strikeouts, third in the country in strikeouts.
And while we have the time, I want to thank our production crew who have been working really long days and nights. Matt Sanduli, our producer, Steve Turnberger, our director, Ed Sfida, the stat man, back here on the East Coast where it's after 2 a.m. on the East Coast. And all you Michigan fans staying up late, what a season it was. And really too bad that Michigan has to go out in the regional round.
Well, Pam, the crazy part is,
go ahead.
Yeah, the crazy thing is about this Michigan team, they were one of the potential host sites for regionals, but didn't come away with one of those seed spots. And when you talk to Coach Hutchins about it, she says it was just our whole conference was disrespected. They weren't even allowed to play outside of conference games in the regular season.
Eight strikeouts for Gabby Plain, one out away from the Super Regional. Now the first out of conference game that Michigan played this year was Friday in this regional. When Megan Bobian no-hit Seattle University. Now Lou Allen, one of the seniors on this team. Washington, Oklahoma next. Oklahoma can score a ton of runs, but their pitchers can also give up some runs. Can you outscore the Sooners? Plain on the cusp of beating Michigan for the second time today. It would be her 32nd win of the season. She was a senior, but she says she's going to come back next year, use that final year of eligibility after pitching for the Australian national team in the Olympics. 1-1 to Allen. Now one strike away. makes it. Strikeout number 9 and another trip to the Super Regionals. Beating the Wolverines not once but twice today to go to their 14th Super Regional to play the number 1 overall seed.
Tons of run production in Norman, Oklahoma. How will Washington be able to combat that? Well, the answer right there in the circle, Gabby Plain, the Aussie national team member, going to take on the number 1 team in the nation. But we want to make sure we tip our caps to these amazing Michigan Wolverines. Tremendous season played under some really tough circumstances, not playing out of conference, having to play 4-game series against some really stiff competition within the Big Ten. But Gabby Plain's 9th strikeout of the night, drop ball, hard late break. That one was out of the zone. But knowing how Gabby Plain is throwing right now, Washington looking really good as they head against that number 1 offense in the nation.
And Sis Bates celebrates along with her teammates. Her career continues. As the Huskies celebrate, playing in the 2 games this afternoon, wins against Michigan, a combined 17 strikeouts. Which gives her 331 for the season. And we are joined now by Sis Bates, the shortstop for the University of Washington. Sis, congratulations going back to the Super Regional. You get to play on. Boy, that second inning was a little sketchy. What were y'all thinking as you fell behind 5-1?
Yeah, you know, we're just playing pitch to pitch and trying to play Husky softball. Gabby has grit. We're all having her back, and it's just fun to play behind her.
Well, everybody loves your web gems. I mean, what is your mentality when you get on the field? Defensively, what are you looking for when the pitch comes into the zone?
Speed and direction are the 2 main things that you look for. But truly, like, I'm just trying to do everything for my teammates. And if I can make a play for them, like, let's go.
Awesome. Well, as you look ahead, obviously you haven't had a chance to think about it, but you're going to go into Norman, a pretty volatile situation with the number 1 offense in the nation. What do you think the message is going to be from Coach Tarr to your team?
You know, we just have to play pitch to pitch. Husky softball together. That's how we're going to do it. And, you know, seedings are seedings. We're just going to do it. We're going to play Husky softball.
The disrespect with being, as Jen calls it, criminally underseeded, was that something that you guys were able to put behind you, or were you playing with a little bit of a chip on your shoulder to prove
yeah.
you belong?
You know, we have to control what we can control, and unfortunately we can't control that, so, so yeah.
And finally, but, Sis, just coming into this game, you got the respite. Right. You got to be able to play another season because of COVID last year. So as the photographer needs to get out of the way of
I'm sorry,
shot.
You guys. I'm really sorry.
Not your fault. Not your fault. Play defense for us there. But have you just thought about this season being a gift coming back? Obviously, you're somebody who loves to play softball. Have you even thought about that this potentially today could have been it for you?
Yeah, you know, this is like such a big passion of mine. Oh my gosh, he like really doesn't know. But you just can't let that creep into your mind, and you just have to play together.
All right, Sis Bates, it's been so much fun watching you out in the field. That play you made yesterday from your knees when you were falling back. Good stuff.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. Thanks, Sis. Enjoy it, and we'll see you down in the Super Regional.
Thank you. Go Dogs.
All right. The Dogs coming back from 5-1 down to beat Michigan, and they will roll on to the Super Regional against Oklahoma. Texas and Oregon, they're still playing. Hey, you know what, Gabby? Gabby Plain just gave up 1 hit in the last 5 innings after that second inning, so She really came back, and as Sis Bates said, that, you know, her teammates had her back. They clawed, they got themselves that big inning to come from behind to win it by the final of 10-5. So for Jenny Dalton Hill and the rest of our terrific crew, thanks for watching as the Huskies roll on. I'm Pam Ward as we say so long from Seattle. The dogs are going to Norman.